Hello, my dear girls and boys, a very warm good evening to all of you, and thank you very much for staying tuned to HashLearn. And if you want to connect with me, please connect via the chat segment on our webpage. And if you're watching this on YouTube, please do come on our webpage. Right? And now on your screen, you can see today's topic of discussion is biodiversity loss and its conservation. To biodiversity ka loss kaise ho raha hai and how we can conserve it. So that's going to be the topic of discussion for today. And good evening, Sakshi, and I'm doing very well, and I hope you are also well and doing very good. So in the last class, we have talked about what is biodiversity and what are the different levels like alpha, beta, gamma diversities, and then how diverse our nature is. And overall, we have realized that biodiversity kitna significant hai. And then we have also looked into the various patterns of biodiversity, and based on which the CPP which was given to you, that is the class practice pack. So this is a question from there. You can also try answering it as Sakshi and Yogesh. So which of the following is correct for diversity? Diversity ke liye inme se kaun sa sahi hai? A. Species diversity increases as we go low latitude to high latitude. That means the diversity of species will increase from low to high latitude. Or species diversity increases as we go from high latitude to low, so high to low mein hoga. Or species diversity increases as we go from equator towards pole, or D, both B and C. So in this case, if you look into this low latitude or high latitude ka matlab kya, low latitude it means it is more towards the equator, high latitude towards the pole, and that is why species diversity will increase as we go from high latitude to low. Okay, from pole to equator the species diversity will increase, whereas the first one is saying species diversity will increase from equator to pole. Again, the last one also, C, is also saying equator to pole, and that is why A and C won't be there. B will be the answer, and very good Yogesh, B is the correct answer. Is that clear, Sakshi, Sakshi Pandey? Why A will be the answer? Now in today's class, we will be looking into the threats to biodiversity, like what are the causes why biodiversity is getting lost, or why animals are getting extinct, what are the reasons behind it. Then we will also look into the IUCN red list category, ki vulnerable kya hai, extinct kya hai, or data deficient isko kehte. There are different categories under which the animals are kept. All animals, we cannot say that they are equally threatened. Depending upon their numbers, there are different categories. And then we will look into the methods of conserving the biodiversity. In that, we have two broad categories, in situ and ex situ. So in situ is within the natural habitat. If we conserve plant and animal in their own habitat, then that is in situ conservation, on site. Ex situ is outside the natural habitat. If conservation is done outside the natural habitat, that is ex situ conservation. And then we will also look into what are hotspots of biodiversity, and then Ramsar sites and a few conventions. So let's get started. So to start off with, a quick look into the how biodiversity is getting lost, or what are the reasons of the biodiversity loss and what will be the impact. So if you see here, everything is starting with the human population. So if there is population growth, right, so there will be more greenhouse gas emissions because of the various works which we are doing. Along with that, we will go for habitat alterations because we want more human settlements. When there is more human settlements, more of forests are removed. Theek hai, jyada human settlements ke liye jyada deforestation hoga, pollution bhi jyada hoga, over harvesting bhi hogi. So all these tends to lead, these are the causes of biodiversity loss. Again, due to globalization, there are invasive species coming. The foreign species are introduced, or external species are introduced in different countries, and these species become competitively dominant in that area. As a result of this, indigenous species are wiped off. So indigenous species hote hai, jab external species aati hai, to kai baar kya hota hai ki instead of happily living their cohabitation ki jagah, they become dominant, like the case of water hyacinth, right? So again, there will be biodiversity loss. When there is more of greenhouse impact, global warming hoga. Once there is rise in temperature, that will lead to biodiversity loss, right? So these are the reasons for loss of biodiversity. And if biodiversity is getting degraded or is getting reduced, in that case the first thing which will happen is degradation of ecosystem function, because we have seen there is a fine balance between various trophic levels. Alag alag trophic levels mein a fine balance hai which will be lost due to biodiversity lost, biodiversity loss. And then food resources bhi jayega, loss of tourism and recreation activity. You see, many people tend to visit the, they love to see the beauty of an area, nature. There are many animal lovers who would like to go to a region where they can find good birds. ठीक है, बर्ड वॉच के लिए बहुत लोग जाते हैं. तो इन दिस केस व्हेन देयर इज बायोडाइवर्सिटी लॉस, स्लोली स्लोली द टूरिज्म आल्सो विल गेट रिड्यूस्ड. देन आल्सो सी बिकॉज ऑफ दिस हैबिटेट फ्रैगमेंटेशन एंड चेंजेस इन ग्लोबल क्लाइमेट, देयर वर माइग्रेटरी बर्ड्स इन मेनी एरिया, इट यूज्ड टू कम ड्यूरिंग द विंटर, नाउ दे आर नॉट कमिंग और द नंबर्स आर ग्रेटली रिड्यूस्ड. सो देयर वॉज टूरिज्म, लाइक पीपल वर अट्रैक्टेड टू सी दोज बर्ड्स ऑल्सो. इफ दे आर नॉट देयर, देयर विल बी loss of tourism, again loss of sources of medicines, loss of aesthetic and spiritual ties with nature. So all these losses will ultimately lead to economic loss, health impacts will be there, and social disruption. So overall, these are the impacts of biodiversity loss, and that is why we should be focusing on its conservation. Now we will discuss in detail some of the causes of biodiversity loss. So there are the first thing is habitat loss and fragmentation, then we have overexploitation, alien species invasion, and co-extinction. So these are the major causes of biodiversity loss. In that, the first one is habitat loss and fragmentation. So habitat, as we know, it is the living or dwelling place of an organism. Ek organism kahan rehta hai, wo kya hai, uska habitat hai. So if there is habitat loss due to human intervention or due to any reason, jaise there is a big forest patch, now there is deforestation. So once there will be deforestation, in that case the area, the organisms, the animals which were dependent on that forest, they will lose their habitat, and as a result their number will be reduced. And habitat fragmentation means that if there is a habitat and due to some in the reason there is the habitat is broken into small part, so that is habitat fragmentation. Or habitat fragmentation se kya hoga ki the animals which have larger territory, like that of an elephant, elephants ki territory bahut badi hoti hai, theek hai. So in that case their habitat is very big, and in when habitat fragmentation will be there, they do suffer, and this is one of the causes of man and animal conflict, because unka habitat rahega nahi, so ultimately what they are left with. To come into the human settlements, and that results in man-animal conflicts. And destruction of habitat is the primary cause of extinction of species. So this you need to remember, because I have seen some 5-6 different types of question. Sentence framing is different, but question was same. What is the main cause of loss of biodiversity? So it is habitat loss and fragmentation. So destruction of habitat is the primary cause of extinction of species. The tropical rainforest initially covered 14% of the land, but now it's only 6%. So you can see the amount of reduction in the rainforest. Now once the rainforests are reduced, they harbor a lot of biodiversity. So once that is reduced, whatever animals, organisms it was supporting, that also will get lost, right? And that ultimately is leading to biodiversity loss. Like say for example, the Amazonian rainforests are known as the lungs of the planet, the earth, right? So if their destruction is happening, that means ultimately when there will be changes in the climate as well. Now when large size habitats are broken in or fragmented due to human settlements, buildings or roads, digging of canals, etc. तो habitat fragmentation के कुछ भी वजह हो सकते हैं कि एक large habitat को हमने small small parts में break कर दिया है. तो animals requiring larger territories and some animals with migratory habitats are badly affected. जब large habitat को हम small small habitat में break करते हैं, तो they are the first ones, or the animals which have larger territories are the first ones to get affected. Now the next point is over exploitation. So due to if some animal is very significant or useful, so over utilization or over hunting or exploitation of that also leads to ultimate extinction of the animal. So when biological system is over exploited by man for natural resources, it results in degradation and extinction of the resources. For example, we have the stellar sea cow and passenger pigeon. The stellar sea cow, actually it's a very large aquatic animal, and in this case they were hunted because it can feed, it was said that it can feed all the members of a ship for around 30 days. So only one stellar sea cow can feed so many people for 30 days, right? So that was the significance. Isliye jo ships wagaira mein jo log jaate the, those who used to travel by ship and all, so at that time hunting of stellar sea cows was very high, and because of their massive body size they used to move very slow in water, and that's why they became easy prey to the hunters, and ultimately now they are extinct. So this is an example of over exploitation. We sab humne dhyan mein nahi rakha ki kitna kitne ka hunting ho raha hai, kitna nahi ho raha hai. Just as long as it was available, hunting was continued, and ultimately the organism became extinct. Alien species invasion. So when foreign species or external species living in a different country or area is introduced in another area which is not native to it, it tends to compete with the indigenous species. Jo species already wahan reh rahe hai usse wo compete karega, and due to absence of its natural predator, that is the most important point why alien species do well in the or in unnatural habitat, because their natural predator is gone. So they will flourish, there is no one to stop them, and ultimately it dominates over the indigenous species. Jo species wahan ke khud ke native hai, it dominates on that, and ultimately the indigenous species becomes vulnerable and there can be biodiversity loss. So there are some alien species has become invasive and causes maximum harmful impact and extinction of indigenous species. Introduction of an African catfish for aquaculture purposes is posing a threat to the existing species of catfishes in India. So African catfish was introduced or is introduced in India, and now it is posing threat to the Indian fishes itself. Again, there is an example of carrot grass, parthenium, or eichornea, water hyacinth that we have seen. So these have actually flourished very much in our country or in the area, and this has resulted in the extinction of or threat to the indigenous species. So that is what we mean by alien species invasion. Then co-extinction. Co-extinction kehne ka matlab hai ki if two organisms are obligatory related to each other, or mutualistically this is an obligate relationship, none of them can complete their life cycle without each other. In that case, if one is lost, other will also get extinct. Jaise ki we have seen the obligate relationship between the plant and its pollinator, even under the chapter sexual reproduction in flowering plants. So there we have seen there are plants which are very exclusive to their pollinators. So in this case, either if the pollinator it goes off from the environment or the plant, dono mein se koi bhi agar extinct hoga, so the other one will automatically get eliminated from the population. Why? Because it cannot complete its life cycle. So that is what we mean by co-extinction. If the interdependency between two organisms is very high, so in this case if one gets extinct, the other will automatically be removed from the population. So that is what we mean by co-extinction. So when a species becomes extinct, the plant and animal species associated with it in an obligatory manner also becomes extinct. For example, if the host fish species becomes extinct, all those parasites that are exclusively found in it will also become extinct. So kya bol raha hai ki agar ek koi fish species hai that harbors a lot of parasites, and if there is any parasite which is exclusive to that fish, so if the entire fish population goes off, those parasites will also go off, because that is not available or that is not found in any other organism. So this is an example of co-extinction. Is that clear to everyone? Hello Sakshi. Now these are some examples of recent extinctions that has happened. So you have the quagga. So quagga was actually it looks like an zebra. So earlier it was thought that it is some other animal group, but after looking into the genetic and molecular evidences, it is said that it is some subspecies of zebra only, but it's no more available, it's extinct. Then dodo is a bird which is again extinct. Then you have thylacine, and thylacines are actually carnivorous marsupials. So they were carnivorous marsupials and now they are also extinct. And stellar sea cow, I have already said, they are also extinct. And why? So there are different reasons for that. Mostly it is over exploitation which is the reason for the extinction, but these animals are already extinct. Ab unki jo namo nishan hai wo khatm ho chuka hai, and that is why we should be conserving biodiversity, because once it is gone, we cannot bring them back. Till now we do not have any measures to bring them back or bring back the species. So what we can do is to conserve them and to protect them, so that all the living forms along with the human beings can survive well in their environment. Okay, thank you Sakshi Pandey and Yokesh and Grim Priti. What is actually extinction? Extinction word ka matlab hai, extinction is a in biology refers to disappearance of a species from earth when its last surviving member dies. So aakhri surviving member bhi hai, the reported last surviving member also, when it dies, that means the species is extinct from the earth. That around the globe you will not find it anywhere. So that kind of a species is considered as extinct. And there can be different types of extinction. It can be natural extinction or mass extinction or anthropogenic extinction. So natural extinction is because of the natural habitat changes or natural selection, us pressure mein aakar ke the species couldn't survive, so it will get extinct. So that is natural extinction only. Then there is mass extinction. So if due to any environmental condition there is mass mortality of a species, that is mass extinction. Anthropogenic is extinction due to human intervention. Human intervention ke karan, if there is a, say for example, if there is a habitat fragmentation or habitat loss which is leading to the extinction of an animal, so that will be called as anthropogenic extinction. Now we are into the IUCN red list. So IUCN stands for International Union of Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources. And now it is called WCU, that is World Conservation Union, maintains a document called Red List or Red Data Book. And the basic utility of Red List is to create awareness about the importance of threatened biodiversity, because only when it is listed, we know that what are the, how many species are threatened, what is the level of threat, that they are about to extinct or vulnerable. So accordingly, we can take measures. अब ऐसा हो सकता है कि हमें लगे कि दिस इज नॉट वेरी थ्रेटेंड स्पीशीज एंड द गवर्नमेंट में इग्नोर दैट, बट अल्टीमेटली वी बट वंस इट इज एक्सटिंक्ट वी विल बी लाइक वी डिड न्यू. सो दिस लिस्टिंग हेल्प्स इन आइडेंटिफाइंग और क्रिएटिंग मोर अवेयरनेस टुवर्ड्स द बायोडाइवर्सिटी और थ्रेटेंड बायोडाइवर्सिटी. देन इट ऑल्सो प्रोवाइड्स अ ग्लोबल इंडेक्स अबाउट ऑलरेडी डिक्लाइन ऑफ बायोडाइवर्सिटी. सो वॉट इज द इंडेक्स, कैसे कैसे दी बायोडाइवर्सिटी इज स्लोली डिक्लाइनिंग, दैट और डेटा ऑल्सो इज अवेलेबल इन दी रेड लिस्ट. एंड ऑल्सो आइडेंटिफिकेशन एंड डॉक्यूमेंटेशन ऑफ एंडेंजर्ड स्पीशीज, द स्पीशीज विच आर एंडेंजर्ड, उसका आइडेंटिफिकेशन डॉक्यूमेंटेशन एवरीथिंग इज डन इन दी रेड लिस्ट. एंड टू हाईलाइट कंजर्वेशन प्रायोरिटीज एंड टू गाइड कंजर्वेशन एक्शन. सो वेन वी नो दैट वॉट इज द कंडीशन or how much is the threat, accordingly the conservation strategies can be adopted, and accordingly conservation priorities guidelines are available in the list. And also to provide information about international agreements such as Convention on Biological Diversity and Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. Dekho, along with everything like listing the different categories of animals who are threatened, creating awareness, then guiding people, like giving conservatory guidelines, along with that, all these conventions which has happened on biodiversity it contains the record of that. Now there are various terms and there is a different meaning of that. So this is an important segment. So see, extinct, when we say extinct, a taxon is considered extinct when its last surviving member dies, that I've already explained. An example is dodo, even stellar sea cow. So these are extinct animals which is no more available, the last surviving member is also dead. Now extinct in wild, there is another term called extinct in wild. So a taxon is extinct in wild when no individual is recorded in exhaustive surveys in any of its natural or expected habitat. Like it can be present in a protected area jahan pe ex situ conservation mein ek do honge, but in its natural habitats none of the surviving members are available after. And these are said after number of surveys. Okay, there is different methods to count the number of animals. And if after a number of surveys, none of the members are found in their natural habitat or expected habitats, they will be called as extinct in the wild. Then we have critically endangered. So a taxon is critically endangered when it is facing extremely high risks of extinction in the near future. That means if immediate measures are not taken, if immediate conservatory methods are not taken, then whatever taxon or animal we are talking about, it is at a high risk of getting extinct in near future only, not like after 10, 20, 15 years. In near future only it will be extinct. So that is critically endangered species. Next is endangered. So a taxon is endangered when its population have decreased or habitats have been reduced to levels that pose immediate danger of extinction. Okay, critically endangered is it is near to extinction in near future if measures are not taken. Endangered is due to habitat loss or decrease in their population, there is danger of extinction. So they are just endangered species. Now many species in India are endangered, like the great Indian bustard, pink headed duck, musk deer, one horned rhinos, lion tail macaque and Kashmir stags. So they are already endangered and this is due to the decrease in their population or either habitat loss, whatever be the reason, they are in endangered list. Now next we have vulnerable. This category includes a taxon whose population have greatly reduced and the survival is not assured, and who has normal population but are facing risk of extinction throughout the range. Okay, so vulnerable is little less than endangered. So in this case it is saying that population is reduced but survival is not assured. Matlab near future mein wo bahut tezi se kamne wala hai and it might get become endangered, critically endangered and then extinct. So they are vulnerable, they are prone to get endangered or extinct. They may be endangered species in future if the causative factors continue to operate. Example, Asiatic wild as black buck, spotted deer, golden langur, all these are actually vulnerable because of the changes in the environment, you can say, or because of the changes in the habitat, this loss of habitat or habitat fragmentation ho raha hai. Kisi bhi wajah se, their number is greatly reducing and there is no control over that reduction. तो सर्वाइवल जो है वो कम होते जा रहा है, तो स्लोली दे विल बिकम एंडेंजर्ड. देन देयर इज टैक्सॉन कॉल्ड लोअर रिस्क. अ टैक्सॉन इज कंसिडर्ड टू बिलोंग टू लोअर रिस्क कैटेगरी व्हेन इट हैज लिटिल रिस्क ऑफ एक्सटिंक्शन एंड आल्सो रिक्वायर्स लिटिल अटेंशन टू बिकम नॉर्मल फ्लरिशिंग स्पीशीज. सो यू सी लिटिल रिस्क ऑफ एक्सटिंक्शन है. It is not like it is normally flourishing and like you people can stay without concerning about them. There is concern but the risk is less. Similarly, if the risk is less, they require less attention and they can come back to normal or they can become a normal flourishing species. Then we have data deficient, and data deficient is a taxon when inadequate information is available regarding the direct or indirect assessment of its risk of extinction. So, agar risk of extinction theek se nahi pata hai ki what is the impact, whether it is vulnerable or lower risk, if it is not completely, the data are not available, then that taxon is considered under data deficient taxons. Is that clear? So now on your screen will come the first question for the class, and here it is. The most important cause of loss of biodiversity today is, biodiversity loss hone ka sabse mahatvapurna karan kya hai? A. Habitat loss and fragmentation. B. Over exploitation. C. Alien species invasion. D. Co-extinctions. So what is the main cause or most important cause of loss of biodiversity today? So if there is a extinction, Peru, if the extinction happens in mass, that means not one by one, the entire population and a good number of the population gets removed due to any environmental factor, that is the, or due to any reason, that then that is called mass extinction. And your time is up for this question. I hope by now you must have answered it. So as I've already said, the most important factor is habitat loss and fragmentation, and this is happening because of human intervention. Theek hai, jo human activities hai, because of that only there is habitat loss, and habitat loss and fragmentation is the most important and most specific cause, like you can say that the biggest cause of loss of biodiversity. Now on your screen will come the second question for the class, and here it is. And very good, Sakshi and Peru. Red list contains data or information on A. All economically important plants. B. Plants whose products are in international trade. C. Threatened species. D. Marine vertebrates only. So what does red list contains? What is red list about? A. All economically important plants. B. Plants whose products are in international trade. C. Threatened species. D. Marine vertebrates only. So what does red list contains? What will be the answer to question number 2? A, B, C or D? And your time is up. So red list, as I have just said, red list gives us the detailed information of threatened species, or what is the degree of threat a particular species is facing. So that is available in the red list. So the answer to the question is C. Now on your screen is the contest question that I have asked in the last class. So the question was based on Hardy-Weinberg principle, and the question was, a large randomly mating population, only one person is 10,000 is an albino. So here albino is the recessive trait. Albinism is the recessive trait. What will be the frequency of a carrier person of albinism? Okay, so here albinism is the recessive trait. Jaise 1 in 10,000 bol rahe, so it's a recessive trait only. And then we have to calculate the frequency. So for calculation, since it is an autosomal recessive genetic disorder, it is given that the frequency of albino in population is 1 in 10,000. So according to Hardy-Weinberg, if we look into this, so the frequency of the albinism will be 1 by 10,000, and that comes to 0.001. So Q square value, because that is albinism, so since it is autosomal recessive, theek hai, recessive hone ka matlab hai ki this is being expressed only when it is present in its homozygous condition. So Q square is given as 0.0001. So Q will be 0.01 only. So here we have got the Q value. What is the value of Q? Now we know that P plus Q is equal to 1. So P will be 0.99. And accordingly, 2PQ value also we can calculate. And as per that, it is 2%. So according to this, 1 person in 50 will be carrier, because when we say carrier, that means it is heterozygous condition. So if I express the trait with R, so or A, so those who are non-albinic, so they can be capital A or capital A small a, but when albinism is getting expressed, it is small a only. But as per question, it is asking about what is the frequency of heterozygotes. So to get the frequency of heterozygotes, we need to calculate the 2 PQ value. Because in case of Hardy-Weinberg principle, P square is homozygous, Q square, PC is homozygous dominant, Q square is homozygous recessive, and 2 PQ is the carrier organisms or carrier persons. So here it is 2%, and out of all those given values, 1 in 50 represents the 2% amount, right? So that is why the answer will be 1 in 50, and the first person to answer it correctly was Sakshi Pandey. So clap, clap, clap for Sakshi, and Sakshi, you will get your free atom session credited by the end of this class. Now on your screen will come today's contest question, and please do answer it with accuracy and be the first person to answer it. And here it is. A pedigree is shown below for a disease that is autosomal dominant. The genetic makeup of the first generation is. So you have to identify the genetic makeup of first generation, both parents. Last 15 seconds. And your time is up. So next change. So with this, we have come to the next topic, that is biodiversity conservation. And answer to today's contest question, I'll let you know in the coming class. And the question was actually good. And if you have answered it correctly, that means you remember the previous chapters. This is the pehle wala question, Hardy-Weinberg se tha. Now this is from the pedigree analysis. This also tests your focus or throughout the chapter, right? So now we are into the next topic. So far we have discussed about the biodiversity loss. Now we are into the next segment, that is how we can conserve the biodiversity. So for conservation, broadly it is divided into two methods. One is in situ, otherwise it ex situ. So as I have said, in situ is within the natural habitat of the animal. If the plant or animal is conserved in their natural habitat, that is in situ conservation. Ex situ is if the plant or animal is conserved outside their natural habitat, that is ex situ. So in situ kya hai? Unke natural habitat mein hai, aur ex situ is away from natural habitat mein nahi hai. So in case of in situ conservation, what are the things that will come? There are national parks, sanctuary and biosphere reserves. So these are methods of in situ conservation in that area only. National park jahan par hai aaj ke date mein wahi hamesha se tha, right? That is the position of all the national parks. It is not that it was a barren land and suddenly a national park was created. Instead, when it is creation is there, so then it will be ex situ, and in ex situ we have seed banks, cryopreservation. These are away from the natural habitat, gene banks. So these are the ex situ conservation. Then also the botanical gardens, zoological parks, then aquarias, then arboretae. All these are methods of conserving animals away from their natural habitat. Zoo we can make. It's not the natural habitat. Naturally, वहाँ पे वो animals नहीं रहते. एक zoo में बहुत सारे organisms हैं. But that is not the natural habitat of the organism. So that is an ex situ conservatory method. Similarly, the home garden or sacred plants. These are the ways of ex situ conservations. So in situ conservation, the most appropriate method to maintain a species of wild animals and plants is their natural habitat. Because natural habitat mein the adaptation to the environment is maximum for an animal. So if the number is not very critically endangered, in that case we can go for in situ conservation. Conserve the animal in their natural habitat because they are very well adapted to that, or wahan pe wo flourish kar sakte hain. So if we conserve them, they are all hunting and poachings are restricted, no human intervention, they can flourish there and they can be conserved. So this approach includes conservation and protection of total ecosystem, whatever it is, the entire patch, pura national park hai, sanctuary hai, ya biosphere reserve hai, that entire thing is protected and its biodiversity through a network of protected areas. The common natural habitats that have been set for in situ conservation of wild animals and plants include national parks, sanctuaries, biosphere reserve and several wetlands, mangroves, coral reefs, also the sacred groves. Now here, when we talk about national parks and wildlife sanctuary, there is a difference. National park is for entire wildlife. जब हम नेशनल पार्क की बात करते हैं, इट इज फॉर एंटायर वाइल्ड लाइफ देयर, प्लांट हो या एनिमल हो, राइट, दैट इज प्रोटेक्टेड देयर, प्रोटेक्टेड देयर एंड देयर इज नो ह्यूमन एक्टिविटी परमिटेड, नो प्राइवेट ओनरशिप इज परमिटेड इन दीज एरियाज. बट वेन वी टॉक अबाउट वाइल्ड लाइफ सेंचुरीज, इट इज ओनली फॉर एनिमल्स एंड सम ह्यूमन एक्टिविटी लाइक प्रोक्यूरिंग टिम्बर और माइनर फॉरेस्ट प्रोडक्ट्स और सम प्राइवेट ओनरशिप, दैट इज अलाउड इन केस ऑफ वाइल्ड लाइफ सेंचुरीज. तो नेशनल पार्क्स क्या है, इट इज फॉर एंटायर वाइल्ड लाइफ एंड देयर इज नो ह्यूमन एक्टिविटी अलाउड. बट इन केस ऑफ सेंचुरीज, इट इज फॉर ओनली फॉर एनिमल्स एंड माइनर ह्यूमन एक्टिविटीज लाइक प्रोक्योरिंग टिम्बर, माइनर फॉरेस्ट प्रोडक्ट्स और सम प्राइवेट ओनरशिप इज अलाउड इन केस ऑफ वाइल्ड लाइफ सेंचुरी. बायोस्फीयर रिजर्व ऑल टूगेदर, इट इज कंजर्वेशन ऑफ entire thing along with the animal, plants, all human beings also, because there are many human populations which are living in close association with nature in these areas. So if we say there is no human activity allowed, so those people will lose their homes, right? So it is kind of so biosphere reserves were basically constructed under UNESCO's man and biosphere program. So in this, even humans are protected who are native or who live there only. Then we have several wetlands, mangroves, they are harbors of indigenous or very very exclusive plant. Bahut sare endemic species will be there, the species which are exclusive to those regions. So obviously they need protection. And then we have the sacred groves and lakes also, so we'll talk about them, what it is. So national park and sanctuary I have already explained. Now on your screen is a diagrammatic representation of a biosphere reserve. So in a biosphere reserve, we have three zones broadly. One is core, buffer and then transition zone. So core zone is the zone where no human activity is allowed. Core mein koi human activity नहीं हो सकता है, दैट इज द सेंट्रल जोन ऑफ अ बायोस्फीयर रिजर्व. देन वी हैव द बफर जोन, हियर सम लिमिटेड एक्टिविटी, जैसे अगर रिसर्च का पर्पस है और सम अदर पर्पस, सो लिमिटेड ह्यूमन एक्टिविटी इज परमिटेड. इन केस ऑफ ट्रांजिशन जोन और मैनिपुलेटिव जोन्स, देयर आर ह्यूमन एक्टिविटीज विच इज परमिटेड और यहाँ पे ह्यूमन सेटलमेंट्स कैन बी देयर, राइट. सो दिस इज द थ्री डिफरेंट जोन्स ऑफ अ बायोस्फीयर रिजर्व. And you can see the, and why the human activities are not allowed, because if human activities will be there, there can be some changes in their habitat. So the entire idea is to preserve and conserve the wildlife as such, the way it is, and that's why biosphere reserve has come into existence. Now next is sacred groves. So sacred groves are found in Khasi and Jayantia. So before we look into where they are found, sacred groves are areas which are considered as very pious or auspicious by the tribal or native people of that area, and that is why less human interventions have happened there, because that is considered very sacred and people do worship there. There are some plants which are with which people are religiously associated and they tend to protect that. So these are the sacred groves, and sacred groves are found in Khasi and Jayantia hills of Meghalaya, Aravalli hills of Rajasthan, Western Ghat regions of Karnataka, Maharashtra and Sarguja, Chanda and Batsar areas of Madhya Pradesh. So these are the areas where some sacred groups are found, and in Meghalaya, the sacred groups are the last refuge for large number of rare and threatened plants. Because sacred groups mein generally the people living there will not allow any interferences. Ki jaake wahan pe aap deforestation kar do, ped ki katai kar do, or if the animal is pious, they will not allow the hunting of the animals also. So because of that, those areas tend to get protected. And now since they have been identified that these are sacred groups, even the government provides the protection to these areas, and they are called the sacred groups. In ex situ conservation, the threatened animals and plants are taken out from their natural habitat. So that's the meaning of it, taken out from the natural habitat and placed in special setting where they can be protected and given special care. Like you have the zoological parks, botanical gardens. These are the different ways of ex situ conservation. So it can be sacred plants and home gardens like Osimum sanctum, tulsi. It's a sacred plant. You will find it in many of the houses, in Indian houses, right? So that plant automatically gets conserved or preserved. So these are sacred plants. Then in home gardens also, people tend to plant a lot of plants. So this way, even those plants are getting protected. Then there are seed banks, the plants which are very important or whose genes are required, they are preserved. There are seed banks, gene banks are also there. Then cryopreservation. So cryopreservation, as we have already discussed, is a technique of preserving the seeds or genes or the cells at liquid nitrogen temperature, that means minus 196 degrees Celsius. That's the temperature, that low is the temperature. So the cells tend to get preserved in that low temperature. Then we have botanical gardens, arboretae and zoological gardens, aquaria. So all these are ex situ methods. Wherever you have seen all these are ex situ method because they are not in their natural habitat. Now this is a comparative account of in situ conservation and ex situ conservation. So in situ is protection of biodiversity in natural habitat. Here it is selected rare plants and animals outside their habitat. Like you have the zoo, in zoological parks you do not have all the animals. Kuch selected animals hi hai jisko dekh karke the people they get recreated aur acha lagta hai unko dekhne mein. So only specific and rare plants and animals are preserved. Then in situ conservation helps in recovering population, helping them to develop in their distinctive features, because it is in their natural habitat. So evolution pe uska koi asar nahi hoga. However they are evolving, they can evolve and become more and more adjusted to their environment. In case of ex situ, it helps in recovering population in order to prevent their extinction. So yes, ex situ method is very good if a species is facing extinction in near future. Agar bahut zyada threatened hai, in that case it is good to go for ex situ conservation, because all the facilities are provided externally. There is no predatory things, there are no predators, no hunting, nothing. So they are conserved, and once their population increases, they will be released into the natural habitat. An example for in situ is national park, biosphere reserve and sanctuaries. For ex situ, we have botanical gardens, zoological parks, safaris. All these are examples of ex situ conservation. Now we are into hotspots of biodiversity. So this idea of identifying hotspot was put forth by Norman Mayer. And hotspots are the area where species richness is very high. Species richness I have already explained in the last class. So these are the region where species richness is very high. Endemism is also high and threat is also high. So to be called as hotspot region, there has to be able to fulfill at least two conditions. It should comprise of at least 1500 species of vascular plants and more than 0.5% of world total plant. So itna wahan hona hi chahiye, tabhi it can be called as biodiversity hotspot. Then it should have lost greater than equal to 70% of its natural habitat. So habitat destruction and fragmentation hai. Threat to the population is already there. So if threat is there, it has high species richness, then in that case the area can be considered as biodiversity hotspot. Now in case of India along with its neighbor, it has four hotspots, like the Western Ghats. So Western Ghats and the regions of Sri Lanka, they form one hotspot. Then we have Eastern Himalayas. Again, this is India along with its neighbor, the Himalayan ranges. That's another hotspot of biodiversity. Indo-Burma region towards the northeast, that's also a biological hotspot. And Central Land is the islands of the Nicobar, along with Singapore and all, that makes the other hotspots of biodiversity. Now, Ramsar sites are the convention on wetlands. So, to protect wetlands also, there were sites identified, and these sites are called Ramsar sites because wetlands also provide a lot of ecosystem services and they harbor a good amount of biodiversity. Along with that, the important conventions which you need to remember is, first one is the Earth Summit, which happened in Rio de Janeiro in 1992. And what was the why it was called upon? It was called upon all nations to take apt measures for conservation of biodiversity and sustainable utilization of its benefits. So that is Earth Summit. In case of World Summit, in this what was done, this was significant in reduction of current rate of biodiversity loss at global region. So in this, actually, all the countries have pledged that by 2010, which is already gone, we are in 2019, right? So it was considered that all the participating countries will reduce their biodiversity loss. And now on your screen is the third question for the class, and please do answer it. When a threatened plant needs urgent measure to save it from extinction, the desirable approach is, so the plant is already threatened and urgent measure needs to be taken. So in that case, what you should be looking for, is it in situ conservation? No. Why? Because in situ conservation mein you will never go for urgent nahi ho payega, because it's in wildlife, so there are predators and the plant may get lost. So it requires ex situ conservation. Urgent measures are required, so obviously it will go, you have to go for ex situ conservation. And cryopreservation, biopreservation, all these are not there. Answer will be B, and I hope you have answered B only, right? So the answer to the question will be B. Now with this, we can summarize the class, that in today's class we have discussed about the biodiversity definition. Then in this class actually we have talked about the various causes and the different ways to conserve the biodiversity. And what you need to remember in this case is the specific, suppose if it is conservatory method, specific conservatory method in situ mein kya kya hai and what are its example. List of animals who have extinct is important, right? So the, and the categories of red list is important, and with this comes your CPP time. So now you will get the 10 questions to practice in the form of CPP. So please do practice questions, and these CPPs are available only to passport members. So in case if you are not a passport member, please do subscribe to it so that you can get access to the CPPs. Also, you will get the access to 24/7 one-on-one doubt solving session, access to practice questions and tests from best-selling books, and access to all the video classes covering the toughest concepts and problems. On this note, I take your leave. Good night, Shubhratri, Shabbat Khair. But passport users, do not go anywhere. Start solving the question right away. Good luck.